Morning, Treasury Secretary Timothy Geithner and Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke will testify before the House Oversight Committee on the Eurozone debt crisis. Joining us now, Representative Darrell Issa is chairman of that committee. Congressman, welcome to the show. It's good to have you on today.
Well, thank you, and thanks for uncovering this important issue. I listened to a little of it in the previous panel, and obviously this is a big question. Will economic growth in Europe overcome the increase in sovereign debt in a number of nations, not just Greece?
The Fed chairman seems to be a little more optimistic, obviously, about what's happening over in Europe. Is today's hearing going to be more of a conversation about that, or is it going to morph into some sort of something more confrontational about Fed policy?
Well, certainly we wanted to limit it, and we think we will be primarily about the whole question of whether or not post 2008-2009, whether or not his confidence in credit default swaps, his theory that only one domino or two dominoes will fall, is accurate. As I'm sure you very well know, if the dominoes, starting with Greece, going through the pigs, keep falling, there are scenarios in which we could end up with France and Greece and beyond. So when you look at the impact, Bernanke has consistently tried to talk in terms of $30 or $60 billion rather than the much larger amount. And of course, he's also relying on the hedging that only in the past worked when sovereigns came in to also prop those up.
Let's play a little hypothetical for a moment, if we could. Treasury Secretary Geithner says he has no intention of asking for more money for the IMF. If things start to go worse in Europe, if the situation gets really, really bad, and the IMF needs more money, would you and your colleagues on that side of the aisle be supportive?
Well, as you know, I led the charge against TARP. I felt there were other ways in the U.S. to deal with it. One of the reasons this hearing is important is I want to have our leaders and responsible leaders give us alternate scenarios to that now, rather than coming to us in desperation saying, as they did with TARP, the world is ending, the sky is falling, we need this money, which ultimately got misused as political walking around money in many cases. The American people don't want to have another TARP. They don't want to have a big funding to the IMF. And let's remember, we're at 100% of GDP. We're not exactly the people who can say that our sovereign debt is rock solid and will never be questioned. We could be in the same situation if we don't plan ahead.
So that sounds like a no. And when you give your answer, Wilbur Ross would like to ask you a question on the other side of your answer on that.
Well, it is not a no. Ultimately, just as they do not intend to come and ask, I do not intend to offer or to say yes. But today what we want to do is we want to listen to the two most responsible parties to talk about alternate scenarios to there is no problem. And your what if question is a great what if question. What if the pigs start falling one after another? What is the plan? Can we simply monetize it all? What will be the impact? We just finished a stress test that assumed that a great deal of that that sovereign debt was in fact either hedged or good. What if you assume it isn't? If you assume it isn't, then every bank that passed the stress test fails the stress test. We've got to start looking in terms of, are we making those plans on behalf of the banks, but more importantly, on behalf of the private sector that's been squeezed out of access to capital and has been part of why our GDP growth has been lethargic at best.
Mr. Chairman, in terms of preparing for the eventual contingency that much more is needed for the IMF, why not increase the quotas to the countries with big sovereign wealth, to China, places like that, and spread the burden more evenly around the world?
Well, you're exactly right that periodically you need to reshuffle the deck based on the realities of who can afford, who is enjoying the large GDP, and quite frankly, who has the relationship with these countries where it's critical. You know, the reason that the U.S. Has always been number one is we were the largest economy and we had the greatest to gain or lose if nations large and small went down. Today, as you said in the earlier segment, the BRICS, very different story. China, obviously a very different story. They have the capacity to be more involved, step up to the plate, not just to make money or to make deals, but to actually take responsibility if these things go awry, as they might.
Congressman, let's play. I'm going to put you in the role of emperor here, and this is our own little movie of Gladiator, okay? Thumbs up or thumbs down to the job that both the Treasury Secretary have done, both the Treasury Secretary and the Fed Chairman have done. Have they done a good job?
Well, I would give them both Fs for the first year or year and a half. I'd give them C pluses or Bs for the intervening period. I think clearly I felt this administration came in very wrong. As time has gone on and some of those opportunities have evaporated, they've become more conventional in what they've been doing. And I hope they continue looking at that as, let's just say, the last year or so, that they have to run, do their knitting in the normal way. So, you know, I know the gladiators and emperors didn't often get that, but I think that's the case. Thumbs down the first 2 years, a cautious thumbs up the last year.
An F seems rather harsh. Considering what the world was facing at that time, don't you think?
Well, we can agree to disagree, but let's understand. If you tell me, you tell the American people, you need $800 billion to do X, you never do X, and you do everything but. You say it's for the financial community, but in fact, you use it in a lot of other ways. You get an F because you didn't do what you said you would do, and even if what you did works out, that's no excuse. The intervening period. I think clearly I felt this administration came in very wrong. As time has gone on and some of those opportunities have evaporated, they've become more conventional in what they've been doing. And I hope they continue looking at that as, let's just say, the last year or so, that they have to run, do their knitting in the normal way. So, you know, I know the gladiators and emperors didn't often get that, but I think that's the case. Thumbs down the first 2 years, a cautious thumbs up the last
but
year.
An F seems rather harsh. Considering what the world was facing at that time, don't you think?
Well, we can agree to disagree, but let's understand. If you tell me, you tell the American people, you need $800 billion to do X, you never do X, and you do everything but. You say it's for the financial community, but in fact, you use it in a lot of other ways. You get an F because you didn't do what you said you would do, and even if what you did works out, that's no excuse for, in fact, using money in an often inappropriate way. So yes, an F is appropriate for that early time.
But you don't ultimately think you don't think it ultimately just worked? You don't say that these people saved the world economy, if not just the U.S. economy alone?
You know, the end justifies the means is not something the American people believe. If you're going to need money, you come to Congress, you get an appropriations, but then you use it for the way that you said you were going to. In the case of TARP, very clearly, they did not use it the way they said they were going to, and there are a great many areas we disagree on. But as you asked for, what is their grade? The grade is that when TARP money began to run out, I think Geithner and Bernanke both have been much more conventional in their approach, and today we want to talk about the future. We want to very much talk about what are they going to do, what is their planning, because quite frankly, another TARP, another stimulus, another bailout with borrowed money is simply not in the cards, and that's the reason this is an important hearing, is to say, what if Congress is not in the mood to write unlimited checks to this administration if you're wrong?
Congressman Issa, thanks so much for your viewpoint this morning. Look forward
to
hearings today. You're very welcome.